Welcome to the second day of the conference. My name is Almut Beiger. I'm from the University of Leeds, and I will share the first session. And it's a great pleasure. We have Professor Yang Zhang here. He is from the University of Science and Technology in China, and he works with Professor Yang Weipan. And yes.
Okay, thank you. I'm very glad to be here, and thank for the committee, especially Yves, to invite me here to the beautiful city. And yes, today I will talk about QKD with the imperfect devices. And I'm from University of Science and Technology of China. The main square is in Hefei, and my labs are in Shanghai. Anyway. Okay. So actually today is the Lantern Festival in China. So happy Lantern Festival. After today, the Chinese Spring Festival is stopped. So this is the last day for our vacation, our holiday. Yeah. So I'm in the field of quantum communication. Quantum communication has many subfields. For example, the QKD and the quantum money is the quantum way to exchange key or exchange information between two trustful parties. And you have the quantum bit commitment, quantum coin tossing, oblivion transfer. This means like you for the two untrustful parties, how could you reach agreement in quantum way? And the quantum secret sharing is the kind of communication, but among many parties. Except for the cryptography, we have the quantum channel complexity. For example, you using the limited source to transfer more information, the dense coding, and you want to finish one task, but you use a less resource, the fingerprinting, and also you use less key or less random number to log more information, the quantum data logging. And of course, in the future, if you want to do the real kind of communication, you really need a global communication, so you need to have some scalable quantum network. Then you need to do research on quantum repeater and the quantum satellite. Today I will concentrate on the QKD according to Rob's suggestion. And I'm a fiber guy, so basically the wavelength today is 1550. So we know that nowadays for the many part, for many real kind of secure communication, we use the modern cryptography, or you can see the classical encryption. It's based on the computational complexity, which means like suppose you have the supercomputer, but probably you need about 1 billion years to crack the code, then it's secure. But this kind of security is called a computational complexity security. It's based on the assumption that there is no revolutionary computer, like a quantum computer, or there is no some new smart algorithm. Actually, just very recently, the Google, they utilized some Chinese researchers' theory. They cracked the digital signature, SAR1. So in that sense, this assumption, I mean, the modern cryptography is good, but it's based on some assumption. So people may ask, is there any higher level security? Yeah, there is one called information theoretical security. This one is actually demonstrate, it means like as long as the information theory is correct, it's secure. And this is actually proven by Shannon himself. It's just like if the communication parties Alice and Bob, if they share the random number and they use their random number, they only use the random number once, then it's called one-time pad method, then it can be information theoretically secure. People also call this kind of security is unconditionally security. But the problem is how could you exchange the key? I mean, actually, you may think this is ridiculous, but it happens. For some very strictly secure communication, people will first generate the random number in this room and bring the suitcase to, for example, China, United States, and then put a random number there. So is there any efficient way can do the key exchange? The quantum key distribution is doing this job. It's based on the basic principle of quantum mechanics. It means as long as quantum mechanics is correct, then plus the one-time pad, you can provide the information theoretical security. But of course, it's in theory. And of course, for our physicists, we believe in quantum mechanics, at least in this energy scale. We think quantum mechanics probably is the most precise science. There are basically two types of QKD. One is the single photon scheme, or the prepare and mirror method. The basic idea is you have Alice prepare the quantum state using single photon source or the wave coherent state, and send through the channel to Bob, and Bob do the measurement. This one was first provided in 1984, so called BB84 by Charles Bennett and Gio Brassa. Later on in 1991, Professor Art Eckhart, he utilized the intrinsic random nature of the entanglement and provided entanglement-based QKD scheme called Eckhart 91. Here I will talk about I will concentrate more on the prepare and the mirror method, because this one is more practical, and people use it for most of the companies, QKD companies. We have, so I just mentioned that in theory, we have information no theoretical security, and also the people may see it's in theory, you can get unconditional secure for sure, but how about for real system? I would like to see for the real system, you can never get information theoretical security. So it's just like, for a whole system, how could you estimate, how could you calibrate, and there is a kind of a security level. So now let's go to the real world to talk about the system. Because you are doing the implementation, then you need some imperfect device, then you need some devices. In general, the devices couldn't be perfect. So how about the imperfect device? How could you achieve the security? That's the basic thing I would like to talk today. But before I start the real things, I would mention one thing, that it's not only the implementation security is not only for QKD. It's also for modern cryptography, also for the classical cryptography. Because classical cryptography is based on the mice, based on the mathematics. But when you are doing the real key exchange, when you are doing the real communication, you will use the physical system. You will have the same problem of implementation. So QKD, one good thing for QKD is it can, in theory, can provide unconditionally secure. Also, it gives you a method to calibrate your implementation, to check your physics, to check your physics layer. That's, I think, probably is another very big advantage for a quantum key distribution. Okay, let's take the prepare and the mirrored system. We have Alice, the prepare, and the channel, and Bob, the receiver. For the channel, we leave the channel to the eavesdropper. The eavesdropper can do anything as long as the physics principle allowed. So you need to care about it. Of course, the channel is imperfect, but it's just fiber or free space. But the channel, we leave it, we give it to Bob, to the eavesdropper. So in that sense, the security proof assume eaves can do anything. So you need not care about the imperfect channel, because it's already imperfect, so it's no problem. The only problem is you need to consider about the Alice and the Bob's their devices. For Alice, you should prepare your qubit. You have the light source, the random number generation, the modulator, and calibration. Bob said, except for the random number and basis choice, and also you need a single photon detector. So for the south side, at first in 1984, the Brassa and Bennett, they suppose we use the single photon source, but this one is expensive, and a lot of time, expensive and big. So we just went out using the laser pointer, attenuate into a single photon level. And there is an attack called the photon number splitting attacks. But of course, there are also other attacks, but this attack is kind of fatal. And the solution, there are many solutions, as you see. And one ideal solution, or one good solution, as you see, one optimal solution, yeah, decoy state. Because decoy state is, for longer distance, is almost near, if you are using the decoy state, it's almost nearby the ideal single photon source, just a little bit less K rate. So in that sense, with decoy state and the weak coherent source, you probably do not need a single photon source for QKD. And it works. Then the second problem is if you are using the weak coherent state, if the coherent state, the phase, the sequential phase is related, there will be an attack called a USD attack. So if you want to fix the problem, you either you just using some electrical modulated laser, or you use some random, you randomly change the phases of the of your laser pulse. So this one is also can be solved. And for the random number generator. Random number generator is, we know the classical random number generator can give you some pseudo random number. The randomness is good, but it's predictable if you know the algorithm. So here we use the quantum random number generation. And then as long as it's a homemade random number, for example, I'm using the quantum CTEC random number generator. They didn't do some bad thing on that, and I well calibrate that, it works. But if I'm using the IDQ things, I need to consider. But it's the same thing, anyway. So, and of course, we have the state prepare for the detection things. Except for the random number generation, the modulation, and the calibration, you have the, actually, there are many attacks on the single photon detectors. So the single photon detector is a little bit harder to calibrate because it's kind of complicated. So just very recently, the many kind of research are focused on the single photon detection. And the source problem, the source is also complicated, but it almost can be calibrated. But for the detection things, there are many attacks. For example, the very famous blinding attack, it's by the Vadim Makarov. And they're kind of, you just like, because your single photon detector is not perfect, not 100% detection efficiency. So if you go, if you use some strong light, you may blind your detector. And even stronger, it will change to some linear mode. Utilize this method, the eavesdropper can control your detector. So, and also, you can see also the time shifting attack on the detector. I mean, that depends based on the imperfection of your detector. So, there are many solutions for the, so if we are doing the real implementation, we need to consider about this kind of, so many kind of loopholes or so many kinds of drawbacks. For example, in the mission satellite, we are doing the QKD between, using the satellite to do the QKD between Beijing and the satellite. And here, the source, we are using the decoy state. And we well calibrated the source. So in that sense, the source is a homemade one, and it's almost okay. And then for the detection part, we are also we made a homemade detector. This may looks not very fancy because it's not some on-shell detector. We made our own detectors, and also we make sure that if there is some strong light, the detector will alarm. So in that sense, for this one, you can fix the problem of blinding attack. And actually, we calibrate many kind of attacks, and we try to fix all the attacks we can. That's the real system. Good thing is there is a way that you can fix all the attacks, no matter you know or you do not know on your detectors. It's called the Merriman Device Independent QKD. The scheme is provided by Huaquan Lou in 2012 in Canada. The basic idea is you have the, here is the traditional QKD. Alice sends some pulse, prepare some qubits, send to the receiver board, and in the channel, eavesdropper have the channel, eavesdropper block it and do the measurement and send some strong light to blind or manipulate your detector. And Bob, if he doesn't know, he will be manipulate his detector. And the solution is MDI QKD. The MDI QKD is kind of a mixture of prepare and mirror and also entanglement. In that sense, the Alice and Bob did it, both of them, they prepare. They didn't do any measurement. They prepare things and send in the middle. In the middle, there is a kind of Bell state measurement. It will project the Alice and Bob state into the Bell state, into a quantum entanglement. Because we know the quantum entanglement, you can, for the each party of the quantum entanglement, you couldn't define its state. You just know the correlation properties of the two photon. So in that sense, the measurement station just can only tell what's the correlation properties. But Alice and Bob, they do not know If they know the correlation the correlation result, they will know each other's result based on their own kind of qubit. But for the station can only know the correlation things. So in that sense, even the if the jobber controlled the station, they couldn't know anything. In that sense, they couldn't attack the detector. She has the detector, but she couldn't hack it. So in that sense, this one is a good method. It's immune to any attack on detectors. And it can be practical. At first, Huai Quang see that it can go 200 kilometers. And it can be scalable because it can fit the star type network. In 2013, our group, together with Wolfgang Tito group and the Brazil group, Wei group, we did the first MDIQKD in the lab, 50 kilometers in our lab. And also Huai Quang Lo group, Guo group, and recently Andrew Seals group, both all the groups did the MDIQKD. And the distance record now for MDIQKD is about 404 kilometers. It's a low loss fiber, 0.16 dB per kilometer from Kangning group. And then for this setup, when the distance is about 100 kilometer, it's kind of a metropolitan distance. The K rate is about 3 kbps. You can use 3 kbps to do the voice message, one time pad, no problem. And the paper is published in 2016. We also tested it in the web, in the network. We have four nodes in Hefei. Charlie is the kind of central node, and Alice, Bob, and David. No, any two want to have the MDIQKD, they send some kind of requirement. They send some requirement, and the optical switch will switch them to the Bell state measurement. And then this is a type of network things. It works. How about longer distance? Very recently, Hugo Zimmerman's group published a paper. It's a very good one. It's a decoy state BB84 method. So the distance go to 421 kilometers low loss fiber. The good thing for the better thing is it's not MDI, but I guess if they are using their own detector and they will calibrate all kinds of known attacks on detector, I think the system is still secure in that sense. And then the K rate is very good. At 400 kilometers, the K rate was 6.5 BPS. It's still acceptable. So people may ask, how about more than 400 kilometers? Can we beat the quantum repeater? There is a new amazing result by Andrew Scheele's group, Toshiba Cambridge. It's called a twin field QKD. It can beat the rate distance limit. Means that without quantum repeater, it can go to 1,000 kilometers. It's kind of amazing. And then after that, there are many following works, including my colleagues, several of my colleagues, Xiongfeng Ma, Xiangbin Wang, and also Marcus Curdy here, and the Lutheran House of Canada, many theoretical works. So here I would like to use some time to talk about the twin field QKD, because I think it's important, because yesterday Ronald Hansen mentioned, I don't know whether he's here or not, mentioned the quantum network using the quantum repeater. It's still, I think probably in 5 years, we can reach something, but talk about the real kind of deployment or real application, I think it's still very hard. But the good thing is the twin field QKD can go to some 400 meter, 500 kilometers with a reasonable K rate. So I would like to talk about that. So you can see the first one is the MDIQKD. It's basically similar to MDIQKD. But MDIQKD, you Alice and Bob, they prepare a weak coherence state and send in the middle, and then you project into some Bell state, and then you get a coincidence. This is kind of, if you know quantum optics very well, I guess, you know this is a kind of Hohmann-Mandel dip. And for the twin field QKD, same thing, the Alice and Bob, they just prepare their weak coherence state, but their weak coherence state is phase correlated. When they send it to the middle through some 100 kilometers fiber, and then here there is an interference. This is not Hohmann-Mandel interference. This is actually a kind of a Mach Zander interference, one photon interference. And when you observe only one colleague in either detector, you will know the phase correlation between them. This is the twin field. And also there is a sending or non-sending. It's a kind of revised protocol. I talk about this because we did experiment on that. And this by my colleague Xiangbin Wang. It's like for the twin field, the Edison bulb, they encode their qubit in the X basis and the Y basis. Here, Xiangbin, he suggests we encode it also in J basis. J basis means like you sending photon or not sending photon. So you can see there is some dotted line on the bulb side. Means like either Alice send or Bob send. And then you get some only one clicks. This one can tolerate more error comparing to original twin field QKD. So you may ask question, why this twin field QKD can go longer distance compared to MDI QKD? I can give you a kind of a simple explanation. Because in MDI QKD, think about that, you go 50 kilometers, so the total loss is about 100 kilometers. But in the twin field QKD, it's like you send photon, but you have only one click. So this means the photon only travel about 50 kilometers. So the loss is around 50 kilometers in that sense. Of course, it's just a very simple explanation. If you want to know the detail, read the paper. And then, so for the twin field, it's very difficult because you need two independent lasers. You can think about that. It's about 500,000 kilometers, 500,000 kilometers away, and you should make the two laser through the fiber and the phase is correlated. It's kind of challenging. There are two kind of main challenges by, just mentioned by Marco Lucalmoni in his Nature paper. You need the frequency stability of two independent lasers. And also you need to fix the phase fluctuation of fibers. And what we did, the below is the experimental setup, what we did in China. We just put it in the archive today. Probably you can find the paper in the morning, yeah. And the first one is very good that because actually in Germany, people using the PTB, they do a kind of, I think it's around 2,000 kilometers, kind of frequency and time transfer. And then you can make the two lasers, their frequency stable, even they are part about 2,000 kilometers. And this is what we did. But here, what we did is about 150 kilometers far away. But of course, in the lab, not in, but it's two independent lasers, 150 kilometers. And we make sure that the two lasers, the frequency difference less than 10 hertz. And then we use some reference pulse using the time multiplexing to do we have the reference pulse to do to fix the phase fluctuation fibers. And then here is our result. It's a preliminary result because we didn't go to some 500,000 kilometers. And you can see the triangle. That's our data. We go to at most the 150 kilometers. And if we have a better detector, for example, the dark count rate is about 0.1 hertz per second. This detector has, there are, for example, my colleagues in Shanghai, they have this single photon detector. We can go to you can see the black curve. And if you stimulate more data, you can go here, some 600 or something. So of course, if you increase your modulator, you kind of increase your system efficiency, you can go to further 700 or 800, something like that. And you can see the pink line. The pink line is the rate distance limit, the PLOB bound. So it means like at first people think QKD couldn't beat this bound, but now without quantum repeater, we can do that. And I would like to ask you to also see this one, the blue curve. The blue curve is like with our current modulation and the same thing, if we are doing the MDI QKD, what we can get. You can see at a short distance, MDI QKD has higher K rate compared to the twin field QKD. And at a longer distance, it's the twin field QKD is good. So in that sense, I think metropolitan area, probably we use MDI and for the longer area, for the kind of main trunk line, backbone line, you probably use a twin field and the quantum repeater, probably. So if you want more security, for example, you think, okay, I don't want to calibrate my source. I want something that I do not need to calibrate anything. I just need the source and the detection independent. So this one is called device independent QKD. It's based on the locality and the detection loophole free built-in quality violation. And you don't need to trust anything, but it's very technically challenging because the built-in quality you need 75% for the hearing efficiency or 80%. But for the DIQKD, you probably need 90%. It's really challenging and probably cannot go longer. And also it has some memory attack. It's not real. I mean, the link is secure, but if the memory, if you talk about the memory, it's still not device independent. You can see some paper on that. In that sense, MDI has some advantage. But anyway, so I would like to give some notes on MDI QKD first. It's detection independent, and decoy state is secure. It uses decoy state, so it's secure against the PNS USD attack. But you need well calibrated source. And in practice, I think it has almost no weak points. And for the future, you need integrated with optical fiber communication. And of course, you can also go high bit rate. For example, under shield groups, so say at 10 kilometers, they can go to megabits per second. So I think it can be practical with such a security. This is a drawing for from Otto Eckert, the QKD network. MDI plus DIY. DIY means a well-calibrated source. You probably can go. And there is a, actually, with the developing, people also build a lot of networks. You can see some DARPA network, and here, Europe network, Tokyo network. In Hefei, we built about 46 node networks. But all these things, we are using the prepare and the mirror method. We are using decoy state, and also we are using transfer relay. And I remember yesterday, Rona provided a kind of a roadmap about the quantum network. The first is the transfer relay and then prepare mirror. I couldn't agree because a prepare mirror is very simple. It's just a QKD QKD link. But if you really, I mean, of course you can do for the 46 nodes. If any nodes you have Alice and Bob, you can do the prepare mirror network. But that's really really a waste of that's a really a waste of a source. So if you trust for some middle part of the relay, then you can make it more like real network. So that's what I'm thinking. And also there is some long distance network. In China, we built the main trunk line. And also Europe, probably here, you know better, and the US and South Korea. And also we have the satellite. But I may not talk about that. Probably Hugo will talk about that. So just a random number. So if you do not want to use the, for example, the United States, if they do not want to use the IDQ random number generator, don't want to use China, and if they do not have their random number generator, how could they do? Use a device independent random number generator. Good thing is this one can be done. And because I have limited time, so just some new results by NIST and us. We did the device-independent random number generator. I don't claim this one. I think this one has a higher security compared to the random number generator you have, but it's very big, it's very huge. It just, I think it's good for standard, not good for applications. It can be a kind of a beacon. You can get a random number if you want to trust it. Yeah. So take-home message. In theory, QKD can provide information theoretic security, but in practice, imperfect device should be taken care for any secure system, even for the modern cryptography. You need to care about the implementation security. And MDI plus DIY might be a better choice. A QKD network have been built all over the world. System is now open to hacking, and standard is being established. DI random number generator has been achieved. Okay, acknowledgement, sorry, 30 minutes. So our team, you can see it's people call us Jenny Pan Group. And you can see these guys. Basically, they are the researchers. And also, we have many collaborators outside. And our funding resource. I would like to say here that first, I will thank the funding resource because they support us. And we have the support. It's very important. Money is very important. So I think you guys did a very good job. Second one, the resource is not infinite. I mean, it's I agree with you guys, money is not the only issue. It's very technically challenging. Try it, and you will know how difficult it is. Not only money. And I would like to thank the international colleagues. You can see, actually, I cite a lot of papers from the people. Actually, in the audience, Professor Granger, Hugo Zimmerman, Rob Chu, Professor Nicholas Deason, and Anton Zellinger, and Andrew Shields, and other researchers, Marco. I mean, only you guys gave us, I think, because China, I think we started the quantum research. For example, for me, I'm a GMA student. I just started around 1988. But we get a lot of progress because of we read a lot of papers from you guys. And yeah, I hope I can I can give some feedback to you guys. I think now Anton Zellinger and Paolo Veloci is using our satellite to do QKD. So I think that's the only way that science can go ahead. So we are not stupid Donald Trump, right? So be smart. I think that's the only way to push the science. And merci. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot for telling us about the latest developments in quantum networking. We have time for one or two questions. Any questions? Good, then let's thank the speaker again.
I hope it's not because of my English.
No, it's very nice, thank you. So now our next speaker will set up. Our next speaker is Philippe Deluc. He is a chief technology officer from Atos, Big Data and Security. And,
is it working? Good.
Good. Do you have your slides?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, can we switch? Okay.
Good.
Do you
okay.
have a is it here? Okay.
Here. Is it working? Good.
Okay. Thank you very much. So I am Philippe Deluc. I am the CTO of Big Data and Security in Atos. Atos is a European company dedicated to digital transformation. And we have launched a quantum program. And I will explain you why we have launched this program. I will discuss with you about business and about customers. So, first thing. Why are we begin with quantum computing? For two reasons. The first reason is linked to the fact that we are a supercomputing leader in the world. We are selling supercomputers. We are delivering, for example, petafloppy computers, and we will deliver in several years exafloppy computers. That means 1 billion operations per second. Up to now, it was very easy to develop a supercomputer because the Moore's law, which states that every 18 months, you have a doubling of the power just because the evolution, the technical evolution of the chips. But we have a problem because this law will slow and finally stop. Why? It's because today we are the technology is around 10 nanometers and there is only 0.3 nanometers between two atoms of silicon in the crystal. That means that you see, in this area, we will have a problem. We will not know how in the future to have this increase of power. But our customer wants this power. What to do? Different possibilities. To explore the 3D CPUs as the American government with a lot of money. Why not biocomputing with biological processing unit. Why not? It seems very promising. Some startup are working on the optical processing unit. It's also a solution. We are monitoring all these possibilities, but we have decided to go in the direction of quantum computing. Why? It's because in 1994, we have a real revolution in the quantum computing with the Shor algorithm. You see here the on the quantum zoo, you see the number of quantum algorithms which has been discovered, and here it's the Shor algorithm. He is the first to have proved that it was possible to have an exponential acceleration with quantum computing. And this one was an algorithmic innovation, and we have now a list of algorithms with various speedup between polynomial up to exponential, with the Grover algorithm, with the HHL algorithm to solve a large linear system. It's an exponential speedup. We have Shor, we have the quantum phase estimation, which is very interesting also. We have several algorithms with a proven speedup. So for us, it's interesting to have this, and for that reason, there is another reason, for the disruption, two reasons. First one is supercomputing. The second one, because we are also a cybersecurity leader around the world, it's the cybersecurity problem which has been launched by the Shor algorithm. What we have here today, we have in the pre-quantum, today in the past, we have this problem of factorization. And you know, here you have the record of factorization, it's the RSA 768. It was necessary to have 2 years of computing with several big servers to factorize this number. It's not big, it's a small number. But to find these two numbers, it has taken this one because we have, for this operation in the classical way, we have an exponential complexity. What is very interesting is, it does not work anymore. Today, what is implemented on internet and so on is the RSA. RSA is Riversham-Adelman. It's a very famous asymmetric cryptographic algorithm. And today, we have implemented the RSA 1024. And you see, because it is exponential, the complexity of the RSA 1024 is the complexity of this one, the RSA 768, multiplied by 10 power 37. It's very big because it is exponential. But the problem with the Shor in the post-quantum is that it's polynomial time, any more exponential time, and that means it may be instantaneous if you have a big quantum computer with several thousands logical qubits, it may be almost instantaneous. But the problem is that the complexity of the RSA 1024 is the complexity of this one multiplied by only 3, because it's a polynomial. It's a polynomial time. These are not the real figures. It's just approximation to give you the flavors of the difference between exponential and polynomial. That means that we have a big problem. The big problem is that we have a critical risk because all these algorithms are used today to secure the internet. It's very high impact, but today it's a low probability. Why? It's because the condition is to have a big quantum computer with several thousand logical qubits. It's not for tomorrow, not for the day tomorrow. In my personal opinion, we have to wait for at least 10 or 20 years for that. It's not tomorrow. That means it's a low probability, but we have to think about it. It is for these two reasons, supercomputing and cybersecurity, that Atos has decided to launch this quantum computing program. It's a need, a real need. It's a business need, because quantum computing will affect sooner or later our customers, supercomputing customers and the cybersecurity consumers, and there is a business rationale about that. This is really a strategic move to keep the business leading position. We are first around the world on the supercomputing and first in Europe about cybersecurity. We are aiming a mid-term return on invest, it's money, not short-term. We have decided to take the risk, but we want to have a mid-term return on invest, and for that we need to keep in touch with customers. So customers for us, it's very important. All this program has been done for the customers. The program is very simple. We have only three topics in the program. First one, we have decided to launch, to commercialize development platform. It's an appliance. With this appliance, you can develop program. We have an assembly language. We have high level language based on Python. And we can optimize the programs. And after, you can test the program through emulation up to 41 qubits. It's normal to be limited to in number of qubits because there is a combinatorial explosion. The second topic in our program is to deliver a real quantum accelerator. And we are committed to do this before 2023 to have a real quantum accelerator between 50 and 100 physical qubits for hybrid computing. And this accelerator will be coupled with the QLM, the Atos QLM, which will be the interface. And you will be able to program the algorithm on the QLM and after to test on the emulator or to run really on the quantum accelerator. And the last topic in our program is the cybersecurity issue. It's not really quantum, but it's embedded in our program. It's the what we're doing in the field of quantum safe cybersecurity or post-quantum cybersecurity. We are aligned with the NIST initiative to develop standards in post-quantum security. And we are preparing the cryptographing to put post-quantum standards in our cybersecurity products, encryptors, HSM, and so on. And now I want to come back on the, just a word about the QLM. QLM was the first topic in our program. So it was really a big success because we have launched this appliance. You see the appliance here some 18 months ago. And we had known a very big success with a lot of customers. You have here a list of customers who has bought a QLM. And what is interesting to see is that we have four types of customers. First one is education, universities, for the students, for training, learning, and so on. It was our first ID, and the name Quantum Learning Machine, it's to learn quantum. But not only education, we have also research centers, like one of our first customer is the Oak Ridge National Laboratory in the United States, with the professor Travis Hamble. He is using the QLM for developing the quantum algorithm to optimize and to have a lot of run on the emulator. And finally, he will check the program on a real accelerator like IBM Experience or the Rigetti solution. But he has saved a lot of time by using the QLM. And all these people in the research side are developing quantum algorithms, for example, nuclear physics for some of them. In the example, we have Oak Ridge, we have also Argonne, another American lab, we have the CA, thank you CA, we are here and also something very important for the CA. On the university, we have, for example, Austria, Université de Reims, and so on. The third type of customer is the HPC ecosystem. Why? HPC ecosystem, you have around the world some organization selling HPC time for their customer. And all these HPC ecosystem have the same approach than us. They say quantum computing will be the future for us with the end of the Moore's Law. And a lot of HPC organizations are trying to engage in quantum computing. And we have, for example, Sursara in the Netherlands, R3 Center in UK, and so on. These are HPC centers, and they want to prepare the future of the computing with the QLM. And the last one, but not least, it's industry. Industry, for us, it's the final objective, the real customers. For example, we have here, we have Bayer. We have recently signed a contract also with a big name in France, in a French company, very famous in the oil and gas. And this industrial customer, it's just the beginning, only few of them for the moment, they want to begin to study the possibility to use application, quantum application, and to test them. And for this, they use the QLM. Now, about customers, what can we say? I want to ask you a question. In your opinion, why are customers going to pay for quantum computing? Do you have answers? I propose you an answer. Perhaps it's by love of quantum physics, because we have a lot of joy and pleasure in working on quantum physics. But no, what want the companies? They want to solve business issues they cannot solve with traditionality for value creation and differentiation against the competition. That is the objective of the customers. For that, they need to run business application, demonstrating quantum advantage. And for that, we need to have quantum algorithms inside the quantum applications with quantum speedup, polynomial, and up to exponential. And last condition, not too far, because for a company, after 3 years, no interest. The objective, the horizon for the company is 3 years. All the company are designing a plan, a strategic plan, never more than 3 years. So 3 years is the horizon for the companies, for the customers. Well, what is the answer, the response of Atos towards these customers? What we have decided is to put a priority on the business applications with quantum advantages, because our customers, they want, it is what they want. What is interesting in that discussion is that we have entered the NSQ era, you know, and noisy intermediate scale quantum computing. It has been introduced by John Preskill, end of 2017. And we have decided, first we are sharing the fact that we are entering this era with quantum advantage. I remind you, it is system with between 50 and 100 qubits, physical qubits, without error correction, and it is coming, it is arriving, and we are sharing this, and we are committed to develop, to propose an atom quantum accelerator within 3-5 years, and it was in my previous slides. What we have decided within our program is to invest in the software, in the middleware, in the global architecture, but not on hardware. That means that we will develop partnerships on the hardware side. And what we want to do is to develop and optimize NESQ algorithms and application with our customers. We have launched several POC, proof of concept, with the customer, like Bayer, for example. And we focus on shallow circuits, short circuits, for hybrid algorithms like the VQE in chemical chemistry, or the machine learning with QAOA, or combinatorial optimization. We have also an interest in digital quantum simulation, quantum chemistry, material science, nuclear physics, and as I told you, we have already engaged some POC with industrial customers. This is globally what we want to do, what we are focusing within our program. A word about our tool, which is the Atos QLM. What is important to know is when you develop program, this program, the performance of the program, of the quantum algorithm, are strongly hardware dependent. Three topics. First one is the topology and the connectivity. Just an example, you have a very simple example of connectivity between 5 qubits. If your program is you have a gate between this qubit and this qubit, it will not function. You have to change the program, you have to optimize, because you have not a connectivity between these two qubits. That means that when you develop a program, you have to take into account the physical constraint, like the connectivity. The second one is the coherence, the stability. You know that we have, for example, we are working on principally with partners on three technology, the trapped ion technology, the superconducting technology, and the semiconducting technology, and also optical technology. And for each of them, you have not the same stability, you have not the same noise models, and we have to take this into account if you want a realistic simulation. The last one is also very important, it is the speed, the shallowness of the circuit, because if your circuit is too slow, you will have propagation of the noise. So we have to reduce the size of the circuit and to accelerate the circuit. And we are taking all this into account. That means that we are developing a simulator which depends, which integrates this constraint. We have integrated the noise models, we are integrating the topology. We have, for example, in our system, a topological optimizer. It will change automatically your program if you have this type of problem because of the connectivity. And also, what is important is that you will be able to provide your customer with the real results of the running, not theoretical mathematical results of the running. And we will provide the true performance over present and future accelerators. Just very fast now, just first, one thing which is very important for our customer is to have a simulator which is fast enough to be usable in operational time. So we have made some benchmark and we have focused on the speed of our simulator. So you see the comparison here. Another example is the optimization. I told you that it was very important to reduce the size of the circuit to reduce the effect of the noise. But you have here an example of an automatic optimization, step by step. Here you have the number of steps. Here you have the idle time in microsecond. And you see that step after step, we are able to reduce the idle time. And we have saved 100 microsecond. And 100 microsecond, it's perhaps something very important to reduce the effect of the noise in the circuit. It's just an example, and we have a lot of other optimization and so on, but I have no time to present this today. And just to finish on my presentation about the interest of the flagship for us, it's something very important. And Atos is in two projects. First project is Axion, with the objective to deliver a 50-ion quantum processor. It's totally aligned with our target to deliver NISQ quantum accelerator. And it is led by Thomas Mons in Innsbruck University. And he has a presentation yesterday. And the role of Atos within this is what we are specialized to do. It's the optimization of the circuit with respect to noise and investigation of quantum advantage. For us, quantum advantage is perhaps the most important for our customers. Other project is PASQUANCE in the field of analog simulation led by an Institute d'Optique. And our part within Atos is to have the coordination of the study of the on the application side for the end users, and you understand with my presentation that it is totally aligned with our focus on applications. So for us, application with quantum advantage is the priority. To develop the quantum business, we have to develop this side. We have within the flagship a lot of work on the academic side on the hardware, but they will know quantum business in the future if we have no research on the application side and on the algorithmic side. And the Shore program, the Shore innovation, was an algorithmic disruption. Voilà, that's all for my presentation. If you have questions, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have time for some questions.
Thank you. Thanks for a nice talk. Perhaps it's a naughty question to ask in this audience, but a company like yours, how have you assessed the risk in going into such a big project? You're making all the software and intermediate software for a quantum computer, and there's a risk that within the time frame you stipulated, you are not going to have a quantum computer with enough qubits to solve real problems. What are your thoughts about that?
No, you are right. Huh? When you are in an entrepreneurship in a company, you take risk, you bet. And this is a bet for us. And we are investing a lot to be successful in that, but it's not one in advance. Huh? We have a lot of things to do. We are really convinced that there is some chance that this will be successful. But you're right, we are at risk. And in a company, it's the what we are doing every day is to take risks.
Hi, so I may have a technical question maybe, but so concerning the implementation of noise inside in your simulation, so the 41 qubit emulator that you have is noiseless at the moment, right?
No, you're right. It's very difficult when we introduce the noise. Theoretically, we should reduce the number of qubits, but I think that we continue to have this possibility to go up to 41 qubits. I know that there is some colleagues on the Atos Quantum team. I don't know if they want to answer this question about the 41 qubits and the noise, but I think we continue to have this 41 limit. And you know, the 41 limit is the limit for every algorithm.
Sure.
For some algorithms with less entanglement and so on, we're able to simulate circuit with more qubits.
Right.
But I think we continue to have this limit of 41.
But I would have thought that you actually had to reduce drastically the number of qubits. So it's great news if you can keep the 41 with noise. Thank you.
There was another question here.
Yes, you spoke about partnerships to develop a NISQ-type hardware.
Yes.
And then at the end, the two examples were ions and cold atoms, basically. But
mm-hmm.
the most popular now worldwide is more superconducting qubits like Google and company. So is it a choice from your side, or do you have also superconducting qubits?
No, first, we are not choosing anybody in that field because we are hardware agnostic. And what we want is to implement every hardware in our simulator.
You talked about partnerships for hardware, you
yes.
need the choice.
We have discussions. For example, we have partnerships with CEA in Paris. It's a supraconducting technology. We have discussions with Google, IBM, and so on. We have discussions. And what we want to do is to have them on board on the simulator. And after, you are right, for the accelerator, we will have to have a choice. And for the moment, I think my last slide with the action program, we have not totally decided today, but I think the trapped ion will be a good solution, but it is not decided yet. For the moment, they are perhaps first and in our roadmap, but it's not decided yet. So to summarize, for the simulator, every hardware will be integrated. And for the accelerator, we think that the action project financed by Flagship will help us to reach this commitment.
Yeah. We have time for a last question.
Hello. when you sell your quantum emulator to companies, which kind of problems do you promise to be able to solve within 3 years that can be of business interest?
But there are interesting POC with some companies about for example, the use of the QAOA algorithm, which is seems to be interesting. What I speak about companies, I will be frank with you. We are not discussing with the production side of the company, with the IT data center. No, we are working with the research lab of the companies. We see all these companies think that the horizon is not too far, and we have a first. What we want is to prove that it is feasible, and after to have this algorithm application implemented in the production side of the company, I think it's not 5 years; it will take more. But we will have roadmaps.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. I think it's time to thank Philippe very much for a very interesting talk. So our next speaker is setting up. So the next speaker is Letizia Taruel from ICFO. She is a group leader and works on ultra-cold quantum gases. So the title of the talk is Simulating Quantum Liquids with Quantum Gases.
Good. So first of all, I would like to start by thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to be here today to present experiments that we did over the last couple of years in my group at ICFO in Barcelona. So what we study in my group are ultra-cold quantum gases, gases of ultra-cold atoms. And what I want to show you today is how we can use these systems to simulate the behavior of quantum liquids. So actually, I will show you how we can make these systems behave like this water drop here, but a quantum version of it. Okay? So in my group, we study ultra-cold quantum gases for quantum simulation, as you might have understood from the title of my talk. So these are really great systems because they are quantum degenerate. We have many, many particles, and we can control them very well. We can control their interactions. We can control the landscape that they see. So we can emulate many different physics problems with them that might be hard to tackle classically. Yeah? So, of course, if you have an ultra-cold quantum gas quantum simulator, you might think that the easiest thing that you can study are problems that deal with gases, because at the end you have a system that is already a gas. And actually, quantum gases have been very successful in studying some problems like this. So, for example, the problem of superconductivity or superfluidity, let's say, in systems of fermions, spin-up, spin-down fermions with very strong interactions. This is the so-called unitary Fermi gas. That was a problem that was kind of impossible to solve or not known how to solve classically, and that was solved first with quantum gases. But of course, you're not limited to gases in life, because if you think of solids, the transport properties of a solid, they are really given by the electron gas, which is a gas. So if you put a quantum gas into a crystal of light, into an optical lattice, then you can also mimic all the physics of solids. And I will not say anything about this today, because on Thursday there will be a talk from Marcus Greiner that will certainly present their beautiful experiments on the simulation of high-TC superconductors, basically. I mean, they are really getting to a regime where they realize the model that you think is good for high-TC superconductivity, and they are really starting to get in a regime where you cannot really do the calculation anymore in a good classical computer, so you could really get answers from these systems. But today I really want to talk on the different direction that we have been following in my group, which is basically to look at a different phase of matter. So we can simulate gases, we can simulate solids, but what about liquids? Can we simulate liquids with these quantum gases? And I want to show you that, okay, we are doing first steps in this direction. So if you want to simulate something, you should maybe clarify what is the essence of it? So what is the essence of a liquid? I mean, a liquid is a fluid like a gas. So what makes a liquid different from a gas? So the easiest way of seeing that is to put both in a box. And if you put a gas in a box, you all know that it takes all the volume of the box because it's a system with a free volume, which doesn't happen with a liquid that is a system with a fixed volume. Yeah? So in other terms, you can also take your box and half its volume, and what will happen is that the gas will just adjust, it will take half of the place, which is not the case of a liquid, which is a system with a very low compressibility. There is another feature of liquids that is nice, that if you take a little bit of this liquid here, it will form some drop, like this water droplet that you see here, which remains its shape by itself. Yeah? So this is an interesting system because it has this free surface that it's separating it from the environment, and one of its defining properties is that it is self-bound. So basically it is held together by itself by a balance of its own interactions. So it has attractive interactions that hold it together and repulsive ones that just stabilize it to a finite size. So in water, this comes from the interaction potential between water molecules, which has at long distances this attractive van der Waals tail, yeah, this blue part. But then this is going to make water molecules just get together, but the system does not collapse because at short distances we have a short range repulsion, some hardcore repulsion here that prevents them to getting too close. Yeah? So pictorially, you can see this in this cartoon way. So you think of each water molecule and it has two spheres around. So you have a blue sphere, that's the range where a molecule attracts other water molecules. Yeah? But then there is also this red sphere that tells you, okay, you cannot put two red molecules closer than that. So that's going to tell you that basically this is the typical distance between water molecules, and it's going to be on the order of the range of the potential of the position of this minimum, because that's exactly where the two terms balance. And that immediately tells you that liquids, normally, they are dense, because this distance between particles is on the same order of the potential range. So this is a fact. I mean, this is how liquids are, but it's not a super nice fact, because that means that if you want to simulate a liquid, you better get all the details of this potential right, because otherwise, well, you will not get things correct. Yeah? And this motivated us actually to think about whether this is really fundamental from liquids, or whether we could make some kind of more universal liquid that would not depend anymore on the details of this potential. So the question is whether we can make a very dilute liquid where the distance between particles is larger than the potential range. And because we are quantum physicists, of course, we want to make this thing quantum. Yeah? So maybe, again, to put things in a bit of a broader frame, if we think of quantum fluids in nature, we have some that are gases, like the BECs in ultra-cold atoms. But of course, the oldest quantum liquid we all know, it's liquid helium. Yeah? And liquid helium, it's a liquid. So actually, liquid helium is super cool because it makes nano droplets, it's super fluid, has fountain effect, many, many things. But it's complicated, actually, to describe theoretically, precisely because it's dense. So you really need to know about the details of the potential to describe it. And we know that these BECs in ultra-cold atoms, we like them so much for quantum simulation because they are dilute. So we don't need to know about details. We can describe all interactions by this so-called scattering length, so we know very well how to write the Hamiltonian of this system and so on. So we would like, in practice, to try to merge the best of both worlds, so make something that has the cool properties of liquid, but it's ultra-dilute like these BECs. And for that, well, we will try to make a dilute quantum liquid using a quantum gas. Okay, so this is what we want to achieve. So now, how do we do it? Yeah? So if you take a quantum gas, how do you make it turn into a quantum liquid? So it's obvious you need to have attractive interactions between the particles just to hold things together. So you just do that, you put the scattering length, that's the parameter that controls interactions in your system, to be negative, that means attractive. And then, okay, you get an attractive energy. So you would say things are right. The problem is that in this system, there is no repulsion to stabilize your system. So what happens is that the system collapses. And this is something that is known from the very early days of PEC. And already in these very early days of PEC, where people studied that, they called it a Bose nova because it collapses in a very explosive way, let's say. Yeah? then they realize that you would need some other term, a repulsion, to stabilize your system, but that this repulsion could not come from the standard interactions in quantum gases, which are between two particles. That's why you have this m square here, but they needed to be of a higher order. For example, three particle interactions, and this is very unnatural in quantum gases. That's why the thing was not done. And this is very unnatural, but in 2015, Dima Petrov, CNRS researcher in Paris, realized that actually you could do things in a very simple way if instead of taking one quantum gas, you would take two of them. So I will call them spin up and spin down, just as a notation. And you need to have a certain set of interactions in these quantum gases. So you need to have two Bose-Einstein condensates, each of them stable. So they need to have repulsive interactions each, but they need to have attractive interactions between themselves. Okay? So why is that? Actually, this is because you need to have a system with overall attraction to bind things together. Yeah? So if you make the overall interactions in your system negative, so attractive, things stay together. But this system does not collapse because of a nice fact that you have quantum fluctuations. So this is a subtle quantum effect. Normally we don't see it so much in these BEC experiments. It's an effect that goes beyond the standard mean field description of a BEC that will stabilize the system. And actually they are subtle, these quantum fluctuations, because basically they lead to an energy of the condensate vacuum, let's say, that is not zero, but it's slightly repulsive. It's because the condensate is kind of not empty. It has excitations in there, it has phonons. And these excitations, they are quantum, so they have some zero-point motion. And this whole thing gives you an overall repulsive shift. And it turns out that in this system, it's cool because this is enough to just give you the repulsion that you need. So how does it work? So basically, you have the standard attraction, you have this quantum fluctuation repulsion, so they have opposite signs, they can compensate each other. They also depend on different quantities, so this is nice, you can tune things. And most important, they scale differently with density. So this one scales with density squared because it's a two particle term, but this one scales with density to the 5/2, so it's like a 2.5 particle interaction, and this is going to be enough to stabilize your system. Because now you don't need to do any fine tuning of parameters, you just prepare your system there, and then the system will start increasing its density, like starting to collapse, but then at some point the density will be high enough that this term can compensate this one, and this will happen at an equilibrium density that is very reasonable, and the system will just self-bind and form a droplet. Okay? So these droplets, they were predicted, as I said, by Dima Petrov, and he really named them droplet because they have all properties that you would like a liquid to have, so they are self-bound, they have surface tension, they are very, very hard to compress. If you put enough particles, they really get some kind of bulk, and then the density only drops on the edges, so really everything you would like a liquid to have. But he also realized it's really a super weird liquid because it's very, very dilute. It's even more dilute than the gas in this room. As a theorist, he liked them because they are very simple to describe theoretically, so you can do that in a very controlled way. And they are a strong effect of the subtle quantum fluctuations that we normally don't see in quantum gases, even if we have very weak interactions. Okay, so he called these like a liquid beyond the standard van der Waals picture of liquids that we have, so very exotic liquid. And one thing that is nice is that it appears not only in this mixture of Bose gases, but in other systems with competing interactions. So they were actually seen shortly after his prediction, a bit by chance, actually not really looking for them, in a dipolar Bose-Einstein condensates, where you also have two competing interactions, because particles there, they can interact because of collisions. This is like the standard scattering length description of interactions in quantum gases, but also because these dipolar gases, they are like little magnets, so these magnets, they can repel each other or attract each other depending how they are oriented. So here you also have a configuration where the two interactions almost cancel out and these quantum fluctuations stabilize droplets, which were seen both in dysprosium and in erbium. So now I want to show you what is different and the same when you just make these droplets in a mixture of Bose-Einstein condensates that was originally predicted. So with this, I come to the two topics I want to discuss. So first, how do we see these droplets? And second, how do they relate to other type of self-bound states that we are more used to in quantum gases. So let's start with the first point. So to make a quantum liquid droplet, you first need a quantum gas, so you need an experiment. This is the mess of our quantum gas experiment at ICFO. All the physics happens in the center here in this chamber. That's where we make our BECs. We make Bose-Einstein condensates of the two bosonic potassium isotopes, potassium 41, potassium 39. And this is nice because that gives us a lot of mixtures of Bose-Einstein condensates we can play with to find the best combination to make the droplets. And we at the end use some particular combination of spin states of this particular isotope, just for practical reasons. So because this is a bit of a mess, maybe let me give you a more, artistic view of the experiment. So this is where our potassium atoms are. We look at them with some high resolution lens, high numerical aperture lens, and we hold the atoms in the focus of this lens with these two green interfering laser beams. So these beams, they create a standing wave in the vertical direction, and basically the atoms will be just sandwiched in between two repulsive sheets created by these lasers. And this is nice because then we can always hold the atoms in this plane so we can look at them without them going out of focus. And then another important component of our experiment is that we have some large electromagnets here that allow us to adjust the magnetic fields and then adjust the interactions. Okay? So why did we pick up this potassium 39? Well, because it's nice, because when we change magnetic field, we change these interactions, and if we go around 45 Gauss, then we can make a configuration where interactions are repulsive or attractive already with a single component condensate. So if we put repulsive interactions, we would expect that, okay, there is nothing holding the particles together, so the system should behave like a gas. And we made a very simple experiment to actually see that we have a gas, which is to put the atoms in a box, like what I said at the beginning. So we make a laser box from this repulsive light sheets and a tube beam from below. Yeah? And then what happens is that if we switch off the sidewalls of this box, then if we have a gas, it should have a free volume and take all the space available to it, so it should just expand in the plane. Yeah? And this is exactly what we see experimentally. So a gas expands and takes up all the space available, and now here we can also go to attractive interactions, and for a single component BEC, we should see this bosonova, this collapse, and this actually we see also. Okay, all good. So then let's go to a mixture of two condensates. So for that, we go a bit above in magnetic field, and we like things because there we can have overall interactions which are repulsive or attractive. When they are repulsive, then we have a gas, and when we are attractive, we should have this liquid. So we again, I mean, if we make a mixture with repulsive interactions, we open our box, things expand. But if we go to attractive interactions, then we see that even if we open the box, the system remains with a size that is not changing over time, so it remains self-bound. So then we say, okay, it's a liquid. It forms a liquid drop. Okay, so we do that. We take some pictures of these drops. These are pictures we like because they were the first ones that we saw, but there are very similar experiments done very shortly afterwards by the Lens group in Florence. And then we take these images to characterize our liquid. So we can check the size of our system, and we see that if we have repulsive interactions, it increases over time, it's a gas. Otherwise, you see, it remains constant over time. We can also measure the atom number of these drops, and we see that they tend to lose particles over time. This we understand, actually, we have inelastic processes that are kicking particles out of the drop that come from three-body recombination. But this is actually a nice feature, because I told you, okay, we have repulsive interactions, we have a gas, if we have attractive interactions, we have a liquid. This is a bit too simplistic, because actually we also have another axis in our phase diagram, which is atom number. So if you want to have a liquid, you also need to have sufficiently large number of particles, and this is because we don't have only interactions in this system, but we also have kinetic energy, and kinetic energy, it's a quantum pressure. It acts like a repulsive force. So if you have very low atom number, then basically this kinetic energy is important compared to the interaction terms, and it can unbind the system into a gas. So actually, if you check on these images where it looked like nothing is changing, the size of the system is remaining constant over time. Yeah, okay, sorry. When you just prepare your system here, if you are losing particles, you can move here. Yeah? So then you can see that you have liquid, and then at some point it starts to increase in size, so it goes into a gas. So you see a liquid to gas transition here that you can see by eye actually directly on the images. So you can put things together, and then you see that for a large range of atom numbers, your system doesn't change in size, so it's a liquid, and then suddenly it starts expanding, so that's why the size starts increasing here, and then it goes into a gas. Then when you plot things like this, it's pretty obvious to see, well, okay, the phase transition is here. Yeah? You can also check in densities that we also measure directly, and you see, okay, you have a system with a density which remains constant over time until suddenly it starts to expand, the density drops abruptly, and that's where the phase transition happens. And you see these densities, they are really super low, and this system is actually super weakly interacting. Yeah? But still, it behaves like a liquid. Then once we do all this, and we say, okay, we have this system that is very nicely tunable, we can change parameters very well, right? That's why we like these quantum gases for quantum simulation. So let's change the strength of the attraction, repeat this experiment many times, and then we see that if we put more attraction, then the phase transition point moves, yeah? And it moves towards lower atom numbers, which also makes sense, because if you have more attraction, you can stand for longer this effect of quantum pressure before you have to unbind. And then we can map out the phase transition line between the liquid and the gas, and we can also check what's the typical size of the droplets that we realize. And if you have more attraction, they get smaller. That also makes sense. Okay, if you have a quantum simulation, you would like to benchmark it to theory. So we compare our experimental results to the model we based our experiments on. And you see that it agrees, but not quite. Actually, the model is approximate. Yeah? So there are approximations that are not well controlled. It predicts well that there is a phase, but it's not obvious. It should work well when you go more and more attractive. The experiment might also have some uncontrolled problems. Yeah? So what we are doing now is to compare to more advanced theory. So we are comparing to quantum Monte Carlo simulations. And these are still preliminary results. When we put all the details of the experiment in there, it really looks like it goes on top of the experimental points. But we don't have really good intuition yet. Why is that? I mean, what is really not working on the effective analytical model? So this is really a work in progress. Also because there were experiments at length done in a different regime. And there, the Monte Carlo and the analytical theory go together with the experiment. In our case, it seems like we are in a different regime. But there is physics to understand still, which I think is nice because it's telling you that you can make really super simple experiments that are really sensitive tests for non-trivial theories. Yeah? So that's what this quantum simulation is about. So now I have a little bit of time left. So let me tell you on another experiment that we did. So what's the relation of these quantum droplets to other self-bound states that maybe in the quantum gas community we are more used to, which are bright solitons? So I told you about these droplets that are stabilized by the balance of two different interaction terms. Some come from standard mean field interactions, collisions between the particles. Some come from these quantum fluctuations, and they balance to form these droplets. Now, I mean, in this quantum technologies field, many of us come from the field of optics. And we also know in optics about other self-bound states, which are solitons. So if you take an optical fiber with a focusing Kernon linearity, then this can compensate the dispersion, and then you can have a pulse of light that propagates without spreading. And if you're a quantum gas person, you know that you can mimic these things in an optical waveguide and create some bright solitons, so some packets of atoms that are propagating without dispersion. And now what we wonder is, what is different between these solitons and our droplets? Or maybe we can put it in terms of a question that we can answer in the experiment. If we take a mixture of two condensates in a waveguide, we have the three terms. So are we going to have solitons stabilized by the kinetic energy? Or are we going to have droplets stabilized by these more subtle quantum fluctuations? Or are we going to have something hybrid? What is going to happen? So I mean, we can do the experiment easy. We just put a waveguide instead of this interfering potential that I showed before. And then we just measure that if we put attractive interactions, we always get something that propagates without dispersion in the guide. Yeah? So So we can do some theory to get the phase diagram of the system. So we see that as soon as we put any attractive interaction, we get something self-bound. It's not like in this other geometry where we needed to have enough atoms for that. Yeah? But the thing that is self-bound has very different properties depending on the parameters that we choose. So you can have densities of this self-bound state that span more than two orders of magnitude. And the nice thing is that you simulate this on the computer, but you can also simulate it on the experiment. Yeah? You measure, and it gives you the same. So there is physics to this that we need to understand. So to understand what's happening, the easiest is to look at this line, which is the line with the interaction energy is on the same order than the trapping energy of the guide. Yeah? And then when we are below this line, we are effectively like one-dimensional. And the solution that we stabilize, it's really like these bright solitons that we are used to. When we are well above this line, we are effectively three-dimensional, and the solution are these droplets that we demonstrated before. And actually what is funny is that this line is not like a line of thought, but it's a real line. It is so-called mean field collapse threshold. If you would not have these quantum fluctuations, people know that these bright solitons, they stop existing when they realize they're not 1D. So they should just disappear. Yeah? So there is Bose Nova on this line. And we see that with quantum fluctuations, well, you have life beyond this line. So then we see these two solutions, soliton and droplets. And for a range of the phase diagram, they are smoothly connected. So you have something that is soliton-like. And if you put more particles, and you have more nonlinearity effects, and then you become more like a droplet. So you really connect smoothly from one to the other. But if you just go here, there is a point, critical point, beyond which I put this gray region here, because the two solutions can exist at the same time, according to theory. So this is also something that we measure experimentally. So we create a soliton, and then we go the regime of this bistability that we predicted in theory. And then what theory predicts is that we have only this soliton solution, which is bound by the guide in this direction, but itself bound in this one. Yeah? And then in some interaction range, magnetic field range, then there is another solution that appears below. So the system is bistable. And this solution is much smaller than the size of the guide, so it's really a 3D solution. It doesn't care much that this guide is there. And then at some point, the soliton solution stops existing, and then there is only the droplet left. So that's when the gray region ends. So then you can imagine that if you start in the soliton solution, and at some point you jump into this droplet one, this is not going to happen really smooth because there is this big jump in size that should happen. And then when we do experimentally, we see that this soliton is breaking in pieces. So you can really check where this soliton breaks in pieces and map out this boundary of the bistable region. And we can compare two theories. So here I have three theory lines because below this we only have solitons. On this first dashed line, then we have solitons and droplets that appear but have higher energy. Then at some point in the solid line, they get equal energy. And then afterwards, it's a soliton that is metastable, and the droplet is the ground state solution. But experimentally, actually, once you start on a soliton, you keep on this soliton line until it disappears and you fall on the droplets. That's why our points go up there. Okay? So you see, I mean, we can also map out these diagrams well. And we can compare to a bit more sophisticated theory, and the experiment agrees with this. Yeah? So with this, I really come to the summary of my talk. So I wanted to show you that with quantum gases, besides gases and solids, we can also study liquids and map out liquid to gas phase diagrams. These liquids are funny because they are more universal liquids somehow because they are super dilute. Then we can also study the relation of these liquid droplets with bright solitons and study a transition between the two. And now what we are doing is trying to use these quantum fluctuations as a novel resource, let's say, for quantum simulation, because I showed you that actually they look like a 2.5 body interaction. So having interactions between more than two particles, even effectively in quantum gases, is very hard. So now we are trying to turn these quantum fluctuations into a three-body interaction, so that would really enlarge the range of models that we could hope to simulate in our system. And then, as I say, well, we can simulate gases, solids, now also liquids. With this, I want to really finish by thanking my group. So we now have a change of generation in the experiment because we have some of the people like Cesar and Luca that finish in the group and move to academic positions still. Some actually, like Peric, moved to industry to use all this expertise in quantum gases to build sensors. So he's building ultra-cold atom accelerometers, gravimeters, and so on. So we look for more people to join us. And I want to thank funding agencies that supported our work, and of course, all of you for your attention.
We have time for some questions. There's some questions.
Thank you for the talk. I wanted to ask, you see the phase transition by going from not self-bound structure to a self-bound structure.
Yes.
But in principle, the solid would also be self-bound. So can it be that actually you have two phase transitions also from liquid to solid? Could you also like look at the long-range order in your structure? It is not possible in your experiment.
So you would like to see a solid transition. So a solid we would see also because it breaks some translational symmetry, right? So you should see, I mean, in dipolar gases, they also try to see a transition to a super solid, for example, and then you would have some structure appearing that we would image, but here it's not expected to occur because there is nothing like would break translational symmetry.
Hmm? Okay, thanks.
We had a question here. On
the I was wondering, where do you see applications of this?
Okay, that's a very good question. So if you see on the two things that we did, so first of all, I think, of course, this is like fundamental interest because we try to understand better these quantum fluctuations. For that, this is a nice system because we are very weakly interacting, so we are in a nice regime where we have experiment, we can do analytics which has approximations that you can control well, and you can do numerics. We do this quantum Monte Carlo, so really heavy classical simulations. And also it's a system where we can progressively increase to more and more strongly interacting systems, so we can hope to push the analytical and numerical methods comparing with experiments. So this is, let's say, fundamental, but still it's a well-controlled system. For more applied things, okay, if you think on the field of quantum simulation, if we can really engineer somehow some controllable higher body interactions, this is useful because then that means you could address other problems that we cannot address right now. Still fundamental, but okay, I mean, you believe quantum simulation has some applications, this is an application. Then more pragmatically, for example, we had this postdoc that now moved to industry and is doing these gravimeters, accelerometers, and so on. He got into that because, I mean, we made these solitons and these droplets, and we started reading on that. There are all these proposals for soliton interferometry that would be maybe better than interferometry with gas, yeah, because it's self-bound, and then you keep a large signal and so on. And then these droplets are new type of self-bound things, like whether they would be useful or not for interferometry, I don't know, because it's not even clear that soliton interferometry is really better than other interferometry. But I think if you don't explore these systems, well, you don't know. So he really got so enthusiastic about interferometry that now he works in a company, like company industry, let's say. He's halfway on each, and also in a lab, and they try to push interferometers further.
Thank you for the nice talk. I have two questions, but closely related. You spoke about the soliton, and I guess this is a formal analogy to the soliton description. Otherwise, can you tell us what is the effective nonlinearity of this system that
yes.
is giving you this response? And maybe the second question, when you show the bistability, so it is against the magnetic field. And you see this abrupt transition of the upgoing line or the downgoing line. What about the time scale of this transition when you are at the threshold, either the high magnetic field or the low one? I mean, how fast this happens in time?
Okay,
thank
so
you.
Maybe for the first question, so there is exactly a formal analogy between our solitons. Basically, if you have not these quantum fluctuations, this Grospi-Tayevsky equation, I mean, it's a nonlinear Schrödinger equation, so it's really identical to the one that you use in optics. It's just you don't have dispersion, you have kinetic energy, and you don't have Kern nonlinearity, you have these mean field attractive interactions, but everything is identical. If you put these quantum fluctuations, you actually get a higher order nonlinearity. So this is similar to these people doing this cubic quintic nonlinear Schrödinger equation, but it's not quintic, it's quartic. So it's a different kind of nonlinearity. But otherwise, formally, things are the same. So you can really think of these droplets, if you come from nonlinear optics, like soliton stabilized by higher order nonlinearity. It's the same. Then for the second question, I think this is a very tough question. So you would like to know what's the time scale on this jump. We didn't measure. I don't know how we would estimate, because something should drive the system from one to the other. No? So we should, yeah, so we wonder whether we would see noise that goes exactly on this bistability region. In practice, it seems we always follow this soliton solution. Okay, there is noise still, but up to the end, and then we fall. So I think what would be nice is to come from the other direction, from the droplet, and see that you fall on the other line. This is unfortunately a bit tricky to do on our setup, but I mean, could be done in the future. Yeah, that's a good suggestion.
We had another question here.
Very nice talk, very nice work. Okay, my question is about the properties of a fluid, of a liquid. So you say it's uncompressible. So my question is that did you measure the compressibility of a fluid? Another question also is that did you measure the pair correlation inside this fluid? Because you said that you have a high resolution imaging system.
So these are two excellent questions. So the compressibility we did not measure because these droplets are small, so it's not so easy. Probably the best way of measuring would be to really see the density profile if you manage to make big enough droplets that we don't make yet, none of the groups really, because then they should have this flat top density profile. So these, it's not a really incompressible system because you still you don't have an energy gap like in a MOT insulator, but because it's so hard to compress, then you would have this flat top density profile and then it drops. So this would be direct proof of, let's say, very low compressibility. Other things that you could do are like collective modes, and also they should show that. What the Lens group has done very recently is collisions between droplets, and you also see that you change regime basically when you start to get into this incompressible range. Yeah? So it's a bit indirect, of course, but it really shows a thing already. So then to the second question, I think this is excellent question because really it depends what you would like a liquid to have. So we will not have this pair correlation function that has this hump, because this really comes from the fact that basically you have these details of the potential. Basically, I mean that the particles are on the order, the distance between particles is on the order of the range of the potential. So if you compute on that, we're too weakly interacting, we would not have this feature. So now if you require this to call something a liquid or not, I think actually you can discuss with people. It depends at the end what you call a liquid, but we don't have it. That's for sure.
I think I suggest that we thank all the speakers of this session again and then continue over coffee. So there will be coffee outside. Mm-hmm.